Okay, this interview is absolute fire. From tragedy to triumph, the CEO of Bravenly, her name is Aspen, and she has been through a lot of stuff, but she has climbed through that fire, through that rubble, and created a massive movement, and she's absolutely incredible. You're going to love her. Enjoy this interview.
A couple things that you're going to hear today, from tragedy to triumph, you're going to hear the one word that changed this person's entire world. She is a CEO of a company, has five kids. She's been in the network marketing industry for quite a while, and she is just a rock star. Been through a lot of different things that she's going to share with you, and I think it's really going to bring you some hope. And so I'm excited to have her as my guest. I'm excited to learn more about her. And I think that you're going to love it as well. So please help me welcome Aspen Emry. Aspen, how are you?
Great. How are you? Thank you so much for having me on here today.
For sure. For sure. I'm excited to have you on. Thanks for being on. Because I mean, obviously you're super, super busy. You got your event coming up that I'm excited to be speaking at. And you just running an entire company. So yeah, that'll make you pretty busy. My first question is, how did you get introduced to network marketing? Like what's your story? Who introduced you? How did that go down?
Well, I often say that I'm probably like a lot of people out there. I wasn't looking. I was buried in the busyness of my own life at the time. It was a little over 17 years ago. And I know in the intro you shared that I have five kids. At the time I had three. Sometimes I say I only had three, but let's not downplay how busy any children are, right? So I had a three-year-old, a 1.5-year-old, and a baby, all boys. And I happened to be at church one Sunday, off in a little private area where you can, have your nursing baby over there, watch the sermon. And there was a mom there, someone that I'd say was just an acquaintance, not someone I knew well, but I knew her name. And I joke sometimes that I think she probably signed up 15 minutes before church because she was the picture of ignorance on fire. She didn't show up with the flip chart or anything. She was just like, hey, I'm doing this thing. I want to share it with you. And it found me. Network marketing found me that Sunday. I was home with kids looking for ways to make ends meet as my husband was building his entrepreneurial dreams. And I was instilling faith and family and values into our kids. But
now was he in network marketing or was he in something? Was
he doing no, he was building traditional businesses. He was building two at the time. He took over a family business when he tragically lost his dad when we were in high school, and he stepped in as the only boy and the one that could step in alongside of his mom. And then he also started his own traditional business. So I watched him do that. And of course I was there alongside of him. But that Sunday leaving church, I said to him, hey, I'm doing a thing. He goes, what do you mean? I said, this girl back here, this woman just shared with me how I can do this. And this is going to help take us to where we want to go. So I knew nothing. I knew nothing at all. But she shared enough with me that I thought to myself for a moment, why not me? I didn't think until a little bit later, I live in the middle of in a cornfield in Nebraska. I only talk to toddlers all day long. I just thought, why not me? Why could I not do that? And so that's how I got started. I was in the field first, bought a starter kit, and opened the contents of that kit and said, here's what we do. We follow these instructions. I was a former teacher. So I'm a school teacher going, these instructions, there may be an objective in here. So I'm going to dig in and see what the book says we should do.
That's awesome. I wasn't looking either. I was very happy with what I was doing at the time. I was in real estate and I was rocking and rolling. The market was hot. I thought it was hot stuff. And I wasn't looking, but when someone explained residual income to me, the capacity that network marketing can do, I'm like, wait a minute, let me look at this and just reflect on that. Of number two, of how many people do we see in church, or we see at a networking event, or do we see, in our daily lives that could end up being a 17-year rep, because you were with that company for 17 years, weren't you?
I was in the field for several years. I actually built in a few different companies. So I did build to one of the upper levels in that company and ended up elsewhere. But yeah, I was the person in the crowd eating peanut butter and jelly sandwiches back at the hotel because I had to do whatever I had to do to get to the event because I just knew they might say something. So I was the person that couldn't really afford to get to the event, but something said you can't afford not to. So I was that person in
the
crowd.
Just think about that. Just think about that. Like, you know, someone, you know, that you barely knew and they didn't have some perfect polished presentation, ended up, you signed up with them and you know, ran with that for a while. One of the questions is, our team kind of chatted with you before this. I understand that you've, you know, you've been through some stuff. You care to share what are some of the different tragedies that, that you've had to overcome and that other people may be able to relate to?
Absolutely. Well, I share that. I share different pieces with people, and some are tragedies and some are obstacles. But one of the things I want people to know when I talk about my time in the field specifically, but also obviously other areas of life, is that none of us have this perfect journey, right? Life happens in the midst of building your business, right? It's not like, pause, I'm promoting to a big rink this month, or hey, stop the bus because I'm doing this. And so sometimes, Ray, people will tease and they'll say, you know, little jokes like, oh my gosh, you've got five kids, you know, oh my goodness, you know, they make their comments. I won't even share. But what they don't see on the other side of that joy is we've lost five babies along the way. You know, our only daughter is seven and she was a twin until our second trimester. Not a lot of people know that. And so there's heartache in that, right? And there's heartache sometimes in network marketing. I was a top earner and the top earners of a company that went out of business without warning, right? So I've lived through what that feels like when you're not grieving necessarily your paycheck, but you're thinking of all the people you just shared this with, right? You're thinking of your team and the people and the lives you've changed and just childhood things and overcoming that feelings of unworthiness, right? Those voices that sometimes are the ones speaking to you going, you're not going to be able to do this. You're not enough. You're not able to do this. And so some of those things were tragedies. Some were business related. And of course, just the normal everyday seasons in marriage and raising kids and families that have shaped really where I'm at today and the kind of leader that I now get to be. And it's only looking back that I can see, oh, this is what you were doing, God. This is why you allowed me to experience this, because I don't have it all together, right? And I've never claimed that. So some of those are the things that have really caused me to be able to have that empathy, but also to be able to say, it's time to get going. You're going to get through this. And there's a purpose in this. And you can either stop what you're doing and live in that circumstance, or you can figure out how to get yourself through it and get to the other side and allow it to shape part of your mission, your purpose, your story, and become relatable and connectable with others. Yeah. I don't even know if connectable is a word, but it feels like it is.
We understand it. So it's a word. Wow. I mean, that's a lot. Appreciate you sharing that. You know, some people, if they had worked so hard in a company and become a top earner and then, you know, the company fold, they would have just said, oh, network marketing, you know, this stuff is baloney or whatever. And I know people that have done that. They've, you know, had something happen and then they're, you know, they say the profession just doesn't work. What made you stick with the profession after that? Did you contemplate like, hey, maybe this just isn't the profession for me? Or did that cross your mind? Or what kept you going?
I think almost everyone, I don't want to say everyone, right? I think almost everyone in this field who's been a top leader or worked corporate network marketing, which I've done that also, has moments of reflection. Let's just call it that. Questioning, wanting to be sure that you're in the right place or that this is that thing for you, right? I do believe almost everyone has that. So I need to be honest and say, yeah, there were times I thought, is this where I should be? And I literally had moments. I don't want to say it was just one moment, but I had this realization that I was given talents and responsibility in a certain area that happens to be network marketing, and that God had given me these talents. I could go forward in alignment with his will for my life and share and teach. And I also had to realize that my idea of what it looked like to be in ministry and to be in service and to be a servant leader didn't mean it was only Sunday school. It doesn't mean I don't think those things are great. And some of my fondest memories are teaching the 2 and 3 year old classes at church. And I love that. But when I realized and accepted and believed and personalized that God's plan for me and his purpose was, hey, you're in this space. And yes, you can change lives through the business, through the products, through all the things we know, through leadership development. But this can be a place where you're a light, where you give people hope, where you connect with others and where you serve. And that was pivotal for me. And I knew then that it really wasn't my decision. It wasn't my decision. I'm answering to someone else besides myself. And I felt such peace. And my will was in alignment with that purpose. And I said, I love it here. Even though I had lived through some of the not great parts of the industry, which most people that watch your page probably have lived through some of that too, right? They know it's not all perfect. But there is enough good in this industry that I love. I can't say goodbye to it. I don't want to. Yeah. I don't need to. And there are so many people whose lives, both personally and professionally and financially and emotionally and spiritually and mentally, have been blessed by this industry. I can't not be here. I can't not be a part of it, even when not everybody gets it and understands it. That's where bravery comes in. That's where courage comes in. That's where you swim upstream sometimes. And we're not called to live a life that everybody around us approves of or understands or high fives and says, you go, girl, that's exactly what I want you to do. We're called to step out, whether it's in business or whether you have faith or not. Dare to be different. Dare to be what you need to be for your family. Dare to do what you're called to do. And when I got to that place, I thought there's nothing that I can't do when I'm aligned with the right purpose for the right reasons. And when I do things in the right way with that integrity, that heart piece of it. And that's why I'm here still in this space and why I love it in spite of having gone through it. And I honestly think people that maybe watch you that have gone through the company going out of business or the shift here or the shift there or things that have shaken them up, maybe, I feel like that's what makes them great leaders. Is because they haven't always had a perfect journey.
Totally. Yeah. I mean, it's awesome. Absolutely. You know, I look at all the, if I didn't overcome all the different obstacles I've overcome, I just wouldn't be that good of a teacher, you know, because I wouldn't know how to deal with it. And I remember I ran an event. This was many, many years ago. This was before, you know, we had bigger events, but I ran an event. There was like 50 people in the room, and Jess's dad, my wife's dad, was in the room, and her dad has pretty much his whole life made a lot of money. In the 80s, he was making 800 grand a year as a head of IT and Progressive. And so we're teaching people how to make money. And afterwards he says to me, he goes, man, I had no idea that people just struggled with money. And I'm like, yeah, some people do.
Yeah, I've heard that it can happen. You know, who knew?
I've heard it's possible. You sharing all this, it reminds me of, and I'm gonna train myself better. I don't remember which verse it is, but where Jesus was talking about, hey, if someone came to you with no clothes and no food, you wouldn't send them away and say, you know, stay warm, good luck. And of course, none of us would. And when I first read that, the first few times I read that, I was like, yeah, you know, and then I realized, oh, wait a minute. He's talking about how God sees us. And if God sees that we need a hole filled, if we need something, and he can see us much better than we can see the needs of other people, he can see us at a soul level. And if he sees that this person needs to be humbled, I needed to be humbled. I needed to lose it all. And so, you know, he's going to serve you. And just really powerful. Just really powerful. I love your story. What would you say is, if you can break this down, what was the biggest lesson that you've learned through this journey?
I would say one of the biggest ones is that you don't always have to have it all figured out before you just act And there is always going to be an element of faith and courage, faith and bravery that are involved, whether it's personally or professionally. You're not always going to have all the answers. And I think because I'm firstborn girl, type A, go-getter, achiever, slight perfectionist, I say slight because I've been working on it for quite a few decades, trying to not be so much. That's hard for me. I want to know it all. Tell me everything. I want to know exactly. And that's where that faith and courage and trust comes in. Because if you wait until you always have all the answers, you're never going to move forward. And so many decisions in my life came from courage and bravery. And I know that brave can be just like this word we see on beautiful quotes, but for me and for our family and so many of the people that I get to do life with every day, we put feet to that, you know, we put that into action and it's stepping out. And I had a friend 2 or 3 years ago when I was going through a situation, and it wasn't a dramatic situation, but I was just voicing some hesitation and kind of the what if this and what if that. And I love that she quoted the verse that talks about thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, right? We all know that one. I remember running that through my head, you know, during one of my C-sections, honestly. I was just trusting in the Lord. But the key that she pointed out to me that nobody had ever broken down, she goes, remember, Aspen, the scripture doesn't say thy word is a spotlight to my whole future. It says thy word is a lamp unto my feet. And what does a lamp do? If we're holding a lamp, we see the next step. We see the next step. We see just that very next thing. That has been monumental for me over the decades. I just didn't have a verse to put with it until she said that was God gives you what you need for that next step, but he may not show you the next 40 steps. I was talking with one of your colleagues the other day, and I said the same thing. If you had told me as a 15-year-old in high school, when I made the decision to become a Spanish teacher, that the end result 30 years later, I just outed how old I am, 30 years later was, oh, you're going to be a CEO of an incredible company. And this is how many people you're going to work with and coach and mentor. And so I would have been like, no way, I can't do that. Like, I don't know how to do that. Like, I would have had all these human objections, right? But God just showed me Spanish teacher. And then he showed me first network marketing company. Okay, that's a bit bigger. You know, I'm not talking to 15-year-olds anymore about how to order food in a restaurant. I'm talking to grown-ups about products. Real grown-ups, you know, home parties back in the day, right? And then it was a bigger team. And then it was corporate network marketing for a very large company. And of course, now it's this role that I have. But God had that lamp unto my feet and said, I need you to trust me. I need you to be brave. I need you to step out in faith. It's not always going to be easy. You're going to have bumps in the road. You're going to have to pivot and adjust. But looking back, we all know, we can see looking back going, oh, I get it. Teacher, network marketing, leader, you know, all of that. I just think that's so cool. And I bet if everyone on here kind of looks backwards, you can see some of the garbage and the obstacles and the scary parts and the painful. And it doesn't mean we want to go through all that again, right? Like who wants that to happen? But I feel like we can see that purpose, right? We can see, okay, this is why you allowed this in my life. And this is why this is going to change the future. This is why we can impact the people. I mean, even just getting to know you and hearing your story, I love your vulnerability and your authenticity and honesty. I'm like, someone's just so real and you're sharing it and you're telling it and you're just letting us go through this journey with you. That is remarkable. It is refreshing. And you have the impact you have for dozens of reasons. And we don't have time to list them all out, but I hope people know all the incredible things that you can do. But I know one piece is you are real and you are sharing all your realness. And that's all I've ever wanted to be, is be a light and show the way. And however God can use me, whether that's business, personal, spiritual, however that can be, there is so much power in that. And there's peace in that, right? When I know that I don't have to always have it figured out, but I can be driven, I can be purposefully passionate about our goals. I am still that achiever. We're doing this, we're doing this. Here's the milestones and here's where we're going. But it's with that purpose and it's with that face, and that gives you peace, right? There's peace in being aligned in that way.
Yeah. Amen. I love it. So two takeaways from that. One, you know, biblically faith without works is dead, but what does that mean? And I dug into that topic a few days ago, just so I really understood what that meant. And so faith if you haven't tested it, is just words. If you're just like, yeah, I got faith. But if you're not willing to take the leap, if you're not willing to do, you know, do the thing. And, you know, Abraham's faith was fully perfected when he was asked to sacrifice his son Isaac, right? And obviously, you know, didn't go through with that. But faith untested is just words. Mm-hmm. So you can't say, yes, I have faith. I have faith that he's going to take care of me. He's going to provide for me without you ever making a leap. And so I love that. And then number two is I get so upset when I see trainers teaching confidence. And they're like, here's how to have confidence. And first, you got to understand what confidence is. You can only have confidence by measuring backwards. You're only confident of the things you've done. So if you're trying to do something that you haven't done, that's not confidence. Confidence is not what you need for things you haven't yet done or haven't yet approached. You need courage. You need bravery. You need, you know, you need to be bold, and you can step into bravery. You can step into courage. You can't step into confidence,
right?
Because you're always going to feel like you're fake. You're going to feel like you're full of crap. And so, you know, when David said he would fight Goliath, he was confident about what he had overcome. He had overcome lions and bears, and he had protected his sheep. He was confident about that. And he used that to give him the confidence, to give him the courage to go after this big old dude when he was basically a sandwich boy. And so I love everything that you're sharing. And so if someone's on here right now and they're going through some tough times and they've experienced tragedy, maybe, you know, right now, or they've experienced tragedy, you know, not that long ago. What would you suggest someone do? What can they turn to, or what are some suggestions or steps to help someone? Because we always know that we got people on here that may be depressed. We got people on here that may have lost a loved one. They got people on here that are really questioning what it is that, you know, they're going to do with their life. And what are any suggestions or tips around that?
Yeah, well, honestly, I don't know if anyone's ever asked me that question quite that way. I know for me, as someone who is a woman of faith, that's where I go.
What does that mean? Explain, because we have people on here that are not of faith, that haven't ever opened the Bible. They never been to church. I mean, you know, I came to Christ less than, you know, actually tomorrow will be 3 months, my 3 month anniversary. You know, there are people on here that have, you know, never been to church. When you say that, people of faith know what that means. People of faith may not know.
Absolutely. For me, it's knowing that there is something bigger than me, knowing that there is something that I'm putting trust in besides my own efforts and my own steps. And obviously for me, that's Christianity. Trusting in Jesus, trusting in his plan for my life and his infinite wisdom. You know, and scripture talks about his ways are higher than ours, trusting that I don't have to be the everything. I don't have to be that person that controls it all, because he is the author of those steps. So for me, it starts internally. And even though I've had this faith since I was a child, I remember in the backseat of the red Volkswagen Bug that my dad drove, asking him how I could trust Jesus and what it meant to be a Christian. That's been, you know, worked out through the course of my life to personalize what that has meant for me in my journey, right? And there's obviously growth through that. But for me, it's trusting in something so much bigger than myself and answering to someone besides just myself. And obviously outside of faith, it's aligning yourself with people in your life who care about you as a person, who put people at the forefront of what they do. You know, if someone's hurting and grieving, it's finding someone in your life that you can trust and say, I need you to pray for me. And I don't even know how to have you do that, right? There are people who will absolutely do that. And that's been key for me, is to do that. If someone's looking at where do I go in my business, maybe they're not going through a tragedy, but they're feeling stuck in their life. It's what's the next right thing? Not the next list of 400 things, because I think that's when we get to that paralyzed state of there's no hope. my personal life is in shambles or my business life is in shambles. What is that next right thing you can do? What is one thing you can do today? Is it opening your Bible? Is it getting on your knees in prayer? I remember saying a prayer once at 20, I was almost 22, 21 years old, saying, I am such a mess emotionally right now. Now, I will tell you this, no one on the outside knew it. I was getting ready to graduate from college, straight A student, all of that. It looked perfect. But on the inside, I was crumbling. Not everybody knows this, but I was crumbling emotionally, trying to figure it all out. And I remember falling to my knees and just saying, I don't even know what I feel and think and believe right now. But I know, Lord, if you're there, which I was struggling with, I know that you're the only answer. You're the answer. And I'm giving my life to you. And like I said, I had already done that at 5 years old, but it was surrender. That is a thing for me. If anyone's watching and they have any issues with just control, and I don't mean a control freak, but I just mean you want to always know the answer and have it together. Sometimes you struggle with letting go. And in that moment, I had to just let go and say, I'm not going to get through this by myself. And I think sometimes people, we don't like that as humans, right? That gets scary for us. So it's let go. Realize you can't do this all by yourself. Seek a faith, your faith. Search. There are people that are willing to talk to you and share with you their faith if you want to borrow theirs and learn about it. And then find people around you. And if you're struggling in business, find that next right thing you can do. That one thing that gets you back into that action. And also, I'm going to tell you this right now, and I have to do this every day. Okay. So this is like not one and done. Take every thought captive. Okay. Take every thought captive. When I hear my kids, you know, grumble about themselves or I can't, I'm like, take that thought captive, throw it away. It's in the garbage. Get it out of your mind. Gone, gone, gone. Don't say that to yourself. And so many people watching, I know, are self-critical, or they don't feel like they measure up. They're comparing themselves to someone in their company or in another industry, or a better mom, a better dad, a better this, a better that, shorter, taller, whatever. You've got to take those thoughts captive. Don't even let them live in your brain. Just they need to be gone. And that is literally something I feel like you got to practice for your whole life. And I could be wrong. Maybe there's one person watching that says, I never have a bad thought about myself. I never think, you know, no, all my thoughts are pure and amazing every second. But no, most people struggle, and, you know, whether it's just self-doubt or self-talk, but it holds people back. It holds them out from seeking faith. It holds them back in relationships with significant others and kids. And it certainly is going to hold people back in their business if they're panicked or consumed, I should say, not panicked, if they're consumed with those thoughts of being less than and not enough. You got to take that captive.
For sure. Oh, I love it. I learned just a tactic, if you will, to do that. And there's still, you know, I've overcome a lot of different things in my life, a lot of different, I'll say, characteristics. But there's still two that I work on. And when a thought like that comes up, I say, I notice it right away and capture it. And I say, Lord, take this thought. Lord, take this thought. Lord, take this thought. Take this away. It's not of you. And that's really helpful to me. And a verse that came up for me when you were talking is Colossians 3:23, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters. And because of that phrase and just really, you know, doing my best to try to live in that phrase, I remember one day I was just being a stubborn jerk to my wife. I just know it. And, you know, I don't even remember what it was about, but I was just being a stubborn jerk. And I used to have this really great capacity to be a stubborn jerk for an entire day. I no longer have that ability. I can't be a stubborn jerk for a day, because if I'm working for the Lord, then, like, you know, like, sorry, boss, you know, like you just don't feel good being a stubborn jerk. And I'm catching it faster and, you know, working more toward being more Christ-like, being more of the Lord than of myself. And the more that I let some of myself go, the more Holy Spirit is filled. And so it's just been great. And so, man, I really, really love your story. It's really, really amazing. And just really appreciate everything that you've shared. I question for you, because I I am still looking for options to this, but if someone's, and I'll share my option that I always share if it's a man, but I haven't quite, I don't quite know it. If someone comes to you and says, hey, I want to get to know the Lord and don't know anything, what do you suggest? Like, what is that first step? Like, what's the first step? Not necessarily for salvation, but what's the first step to just start to learn more? Is there a resource? Is it right to the Bible? Is it, you know, what do you suggest?
My first thought was right to the Bible, because we know that that's like the perfect word of God. I'm thinking Romans, right? The Roman road, and follow those verses, the Romans 8:28 and 6:23. And there's so many incredible ones. I remember back in the 80s or 90s, there used to be this little poster thing that you had. It was about this big, not quite a poster. And it was a picture of a one-way sign. And it had that, it was called the Roman road, and it had that, but a book, I am going to share a book that was published 20 some years ago. And it was really instrumental in my life. Even though I grew up in the faith, when I told you I was a seeker, right? For people, I know the seeker, and it's called The Case for Christ. It was an incredible book. Trouble.
Yeah.
Yep. And I loved it.
It's also a movie. It's also a movie.
I've seen the movie, and that book just dove in. So as someone who's a seeker, especially if they're coming from a place of skepticism, that was one that I really loved because of the analytical parts and the research, but obviously straight to the Bible. I remember a verse, and there's probably a lot of Christians watching right now that can put the exact verse in the comments. But when I was reading one time, after I told you guys I had gone through that stage at 21 years old, where I was really seeking the Lord to just make a shift in my life. And I remember reading scripture again, right? Because that was where I went, dove right back into the Bible. And it was, I believe in John somewhere. I should know this verse because it was extremely impactful for my life, but I'm being put on the spot by myself right now. But it talked about Jesus praying for his disciples. And it says on the back half of the verse, and those who will believe because of them. And I remember having this moment going, that's me. Because of them, because of writing that scripture, I'm the one who will believe because of them. So it's amazing how when you seek with an open heart, right? You seek with an open heart and an open mind, how scripture can come alive for you. And a verse that I probably had read 30 or 40 times over the years, studying my Bible growing up, had a new meaning. And it's this living word of God. And I just think that that's remarkable. So those are my two. Well, what's yours? Now I'm curious what yours is. Where are you telling people to go?
Yeah. I mean, cause honestly for me, like, I mean, when I, even after I was hungry for it, when I would try to read, I would get like one or two verses in, or, you know, and it took me a bit. Now I read it like a movie. I mean, it's like a comic book to me. Like I finish, you know, Acts, I just whip through that. It was like, oh my God, this is amazing. You know, I read 1 Samuel. I'm like, oh, I'm in 2 Samuel right now. So I'm kind of jumping around. And so for me, I haven't found go to this biblically, because I'm just always thinking about the person that is skeptical, that they may struggle reading it. And so one that I've had a 100% success rate on, of if they do this, they're hungry for more. And that's what I look for in prospecting for business. That's what I look for anything, is how do I get someone to take a bite and be hungry for more? And it is a movie on Amazon Prime called Show Me the Father. And it's by the Kendrick brothers. Have you seen it?
Yes. We watched it with our kids. Yes. Oh my gosh. I wept. Because
Jess and I did too. Because there's so many people like me that are, I would call orphan spirits, and they're, you know, they didn't have the greatest relationship with their dad. And I personally, I think for men, I think that's the number one thing that prevents them from getting closer to God. And you watch that movie and you're just like, oh my goodness, man. And so Show Me the Father, I've just never had anyone watch it and not want more. And then from there, it's kind of like, okay, where are you at? And so, you know, Romans, that's a good idea. I'll have to read it again with that mindset of what if I'm skeptical and what if I'm unsure, like, will I be able to accept it? I don't know. But yeah, there's that movie's great. And obviously they have a bunch of other movies too, the Kendrick brothers.
Well, and I think too, when it comes to opening scripture, it's, are you opening it seeking to find something? Like, every day before I start my day and read scripture, you know, I know where I'm going to go in it, right? But it's praying and say, Lord, show me what you want me to see today. I've seen people before, they're like, I just opened my Bible and I found this verse and it changed my life. What do you want me to see today? What do I need to know? Yeah. Number one, help me to be humble enough to receive what you're sharing. Help me to be open to what you might be trying to teach me. Because if we don't have that, it's very easy to open it and go, this doesn't all make sense. Some of these names are so long. How did people live 900 years back? And like, it's easier to go, but when it's that willing, show me what you want me to, what you want me to see and what you want me to do. I feel like if we translate that even into business, it's saying you're up like, what do I need to do? It's being coachable. Yeah. So on a spiritual heavenly level, it's, Lord, this is not my life. This is not my will. It's yours. Show me what you want me to do. What do I need to do to live out your purpose for me? Because his plans are better than anything we could come up with ourselves, right? We know that. I look at my life and I'm like, oh my goodness. Thank you, Lord, for not letting me make all these decisions by myself. I have free will. I get to decide, but thank you for guiding my steps. And in business, it's looking and copying people who are where you want to be, doing what you want to do, being willing to not always like what you hear, right? I'm sure the things that you teach people sometimes are like, I don't really want to do that. I mean, it sounds good on stage and he's got a point, but you expect me to reach out to that many people? You expect me to do that? Well, yeah, that's kind of how it works. I'm going to share it. So it's being willing, and it's incredible the parallels that we can see just in this life. I think humility is just a huge piece of it. Being willing to trust that maybe someone knows a little bit more than you. I know that every day. I don't think I've arrived. I know you certainly don't. I can't wait to devour material and have mentors and advisors and counsel and people in my life that can help level me up to the next level of what the field that our company deserves and what the people around us personally deserve to have. And I just think it's incredible to do that. And like I said, not feeling like you have to have it all together. I'm going to tell this super quick story for those of you, if you're my friend and you're watching, you're going to laugh and you're going to know this, but I used to be deathly afraid of flying. And I mean, deathly afraid, so scared. I had missed my sister's wedding in California because I couldn't drive there from Nebraska with four little kids. So scared. I drove to a meeting 24 hours pregnant. So I was at 24 hours pregnant. Okay. I was pregnant 7 months, and the drive was 24 hours to go to an eight hour meeting. I was too scared. So that's how scared. I ended up taking a corporate position that required over 70% travel by air. And my friends looked at me like, I think you might be the craziest friend in the friend group. And I'm like, well, there's gotta be one, but it was a dream job at the time that I knew God was calling me to. And how do you say no to that? And everyone around me thought I was crazy. And I did too, right? I'm agreeing with all of them. And I remember, and I had a baby that I was taking with me on these trips, and I get on the plane and I remember beating myself up takeoff after takeoff as I stared at the ground, wondering why no one else on this plane was panicking and freaking out inside. How can they read? How can they sleep? Do they not understand what is happening here? And I kept looking at the ground and saying, we're almost there. We're almost there. Highways in the sky, highways in the sky. It's just like driving. Like, I'm coaching myself and my brain. And I remember having this moment. So because my perfectionist was thinking I needed to love this, right? And as I'm looking at the ground on one of many flights, probably within the first 3 months of having this job when it was the worst, thinking to myself, I might be terrified right now, but I'm doing it. I am not on the ground. I am doing the thing that I haven't done for 8 years that scared me and held me back from every amazing thing in my life the last 8 years that could have happened if I had gotten over this. Doesn't mean I didn't have joy. There are other things that didn't involve flying, but there were a lot of things that I missed because I wanted to stay where it was comfortable. And I remember looking at the ground and giving myself permission to do it scared. And I feel like we say that in network marketing a lot, but it was an epiphany when it was happening to me. It was, I am doing this thing and I don't have to love it. It is enough that I am here and I'm doing it scared. And of course we know that then leads to, I don't want to say joy. I'm not saying I'm like, yay, I get to go, but it is confidence. Yes.
You do it enough. Yeah.
Yes. And before I knew it, I remember even now, years later, I still get on a plane and go, how am I not freaking out right now? because I did it and gave myself permission to be scared. And as we watch people joining new network marketing companies, or maybe they're transitioning to a different company, or maybe people watching that aren't even in our industry, but they're going out on some sort of adventure or venture that's going to cause them to need to find this place of courage and bravery, do it scared. It's okay. Yes. If you sit here till you have zero fear in your life, then you're never going to do anything. I'm just telling you, if you wait for this special moment, like, I will do anything as long as it does not require courage, bravery, integrity, you know, confidence,
real faith.
Yes. You're not going to do anything.
Yeah.
So do it scared. And it's amazing where that confidence then creeps in and grows, but it's just not beating yourself up over everything that you're not. Give yourself like credit where credit is due for everything that you're becoming and everything that God's creating within you. And just be open to the possibilities with your faith, be open to new ways and new strategies and new things that you may need to do to get where you want to go in your business, in your marriage, as a parent, in school, wherever it is that you're doing, be open to it, be coachable, humble. There's no limit then. Like, it's game over. If you do all those things, like, there's no limit.
Amen. Love it. Love it. Love it. Oh, powerful, powerful. Well, Aspen, thank you so much. I mean, we could talk for hours and hours and hours, but I'm sure you have things to do as well. Excellent, excellent. I mean, so many great, so many of your fans are on. They're loving this for sure.
Can't wait to see. I can't see any comments. I'll go say hi.
You have to click over on your end. You have to like click over. You should be able to see them.
I'm just looking. Me and you, we're just having our conversation.
There you go. But yeah, super cool. And I'm excited to meet you here in a few days. That's going to be amazing. And thank you for coming on here and being so vulnerable and sharing some really, really great strategies for anybody that's trying to be bigger, that's trying to grow, that's trying to overcome some different things. And it was just excellent. Really, really good. I appreciate you.
Thanks for having me.
Congrats on making it to the end of the video. I hope you got massive value from this. Feel free to subscribe. And I would highly suggest that you click that little bell. Bing. So that you're notified as we upload new and free content. Feel free to share this with someone that you think could benefit from it. And just know that we really, really appreciate you. Feel free to check out the description for any kind of links or additional notes. And I hope to see you in the next video.